Hi everyone, this is Ganesh Dhonokar. Today we are going to learn about IEEE workloads. Now in the last clip we have gone through what exactly IEEE is and which are the different characteristics of your IEEE. Now in this session we'll have a look out with respect to the different concepts which are there in IEEE. So workload is nothing but a fundamental unit of your IEEE. So that has been stated in as the first point, that is a fundamental unit of virtualized client in IEEE deployment is called a workload. So this is the fundamental unit, like in chemistry we have atom. In similar fashion here we have workload. A workload simulates the ability of certain type of real or physical server. So what exactly this workload does for us, it is having the ability of doing a certain type of real or physical server. It means it is going to have the real or physical server. For what purpose? To do an amount of work. It will do some work for us. What exactly server does? Server serves something to us. We need to have such a server which provides the services to us. Let's take an example. We need to have one server to which we will provide two arguments, or you may say two inputs. And what will be the thing which will be provided by this server? It will compute as the addition of the same. So this is the simple fundamental example which we may have. Then the work done can be measured by the number of transactions per minutes. How much number of transactions has been done, on the basis of that we can measure the workload which has been done by the server. Or we can have similar metrics against certain type of system. So we can have the rest of the things also as a parameter to measure the work done. Then here in the next slide we have one figure, that is figure 4.2, which shows three virtual private server instances. It means we will have three different private server instances. It means we'll have one server and we can make different instances inside that server so that it will be able to serve for different customers, and our partitions in this IEEE stack. So for the same we need to have IEEE stacks. So now these three workloads requires three different sizes of computers. So it may be the case ki in this the workload which we are going to create will be of different sizes. It will not be of same size, it may be, but we can have the workload of different sizes. The same thing has been explained at this place. You can have a lookout. That is, in the server we have created three different workload. This is the partition for your workload first. Then the next one is the workload partition for this second, and so on and so forth. Workload partition for the third. We can have a number of workload partition as per our desired in IEEE. The size again will be, it may be same, it may be different. Now here we can come to know with the help of this diagram. This is having the smaller size, it is having medium size, this one is having larger size. Like this we can have different sizes also of your workload. Then again there are few different concepts in IEEE which are pods, aggregations and failover in IEEE. So we'll have a look out into it, what exactly this pod is. Now as we are aware that we are creating our service, definitely this service is going to be used by the users. Now there are a number of users which we are expecting that they should utilize our service. Now how can we do the management of your users? for that purpose we need to have pods. So what exactly this pod is? Workload supports a certain number of users. It means a single workload or the instance of a single workload will be able to support certain number of users. If we have 100 number of users, it is not the case that all the 100 numbers of users will be able to work with single instance of your workloads, because it is having again a limitation, that is it supports certain number of users. Now this is the thing which we call as a pod. At which point you exceed the load, that instance sizing allows. So we have already defined that this workload will support this number of users, and this is nothing but the pod. So the same thing has been said here in the point number 3, that is the group of user within a particular instance is called a pod. It means the number of candidates or the number of users in a single instance of your workload, we call it as a pod. Now what exactly happens when we exceed beyond the limitation? That has been stated in the point number 2, when you reach the limit of the largest virtual machine instance possible, what we need to do? You make a copy or a clone of instance to support additional users. If we exceed the limit, in that case what we need to do? We need to create another instance of your workload so that the rest of those users can avail the service. Now how these pods are managed? These pods are managed by your cloud control system. So there is separate system to manage these pods, that is the group of users. To manage this group of users, we have cloud control system. Now sizing limitation of pods need to be accounted for if you are building large cloud based application. For what purpose we need to have this thing? When we are going to build a large cloud web based application or cloud based application, in that case we need to have this one. We need to have the sizing limitation. We need to think of it.